Welcome to the Berks County Board of Commissioners meeting for March the 14th. We'll begin with a moment of silence followed by a pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I want to make note that we had an executive session yesterday dealing with contract negotiations and real estate. Is there any public comment on specific agenda items?
Minutes.
Seeing none, we'll go to the agenda.
Minutes.
Yes. Forgot those. Are there any additions or corrections for the March 7th meeting minutes? Hearing none, the minutes will stand approved as presented. The first item on the agenda is enactment of a county ordinance. I'm going to recognize Mike Vinn, our financial advisor. I explained what this is about.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
We have three outstanding bond issues that we're looking to refinance, which this ordinance authorizes. The reason this opportunity came about was that you have two Build America bonds, which was under the Jobs Act in, I believe, 2010. That authorized you to issue taxable bonds and receive a subsidy from the federal government of 35%. When the new tax law came into effect last year, it eliminated advance refundings, which meant you cannot refinance bonds prior to the call date. These bonds are taxable, and the IRS earlier this year issued a direction letter saying since these are taxable bonds, even though you receive a subsidy, you can advance refund those. So the opportunity is to advance refund two of your Build America bonds, the Series 2009Bs and the Series 2010Cs. And we also have a smaller issue, the 2012s that are currently callable. This ordinance authorizes refinancing of all three of those. And right now, based on market conditions, the county would net receive a savings over the life of the issues of approximately $4.95 million. Again, this is an estimate, and we won't know the exact amount of money savings until we actually price the bonds, but we are looking to price the bonds the first week of April, assuming that the county is in favor of moving forward and adopts the ordinance. And I'd be happy to answer any questions. This is just a simple higher interest rate to lower interest rate refinancing. We're not extending the term.
Right.
It's just a simple high
and
to low refinance. Yes, that is correct.
Very significant, actually.
Yes.
$4,950,000.
Right. Can't afford not to do it.
No. Correct.
Very good.
Right.
Thank you.
It's our first ordinance of the year, too.
It is.
It took us till March.
Number two, authorizing under that budget department adopt a resolution authorizing 2018 budget transfers in the amount of $453,536, 2018 appropriations in the net amount of zero, 2019 budget transfers in the amount of $31,050, and 2019 appropriations in the amount of $2,730 per listing dated March 11th. We have two items listed under Human Resources. Item 1, authorized the promotion of Kristen Ketch from Office Support 4 to Executive Assistant in Court Administration. Item 2, authorize a transfer for Candace Romig from Office Support 4 in District Judges to Internal Auditor in the Comptroller's Office. Under Purchasing, we have one item, adopt a resolution authorizing award and the Director of Contracts and Procurement to execute two contracts as a result of a request for proposal for adult daycare services for the Berks County Area Agency on Aging. The first contract goes to Ageless Harmony out of Reading, PA, It has a adult daycare service of $62 per diem and meal snacks of $3.81 per diem. And then Phoebe Healthcare Center, Inc., out of Warnersville, PA, at adult daycare services of $60 per diem and meals at $7 per diem. Under emergency services, we have one item, adopt a resolution authorizing the chair to execute a change order to the contract with Motorola Solutions, Inc. in a negative amount of $24,574.32. This satisfies annualized service costs for project components not yet completed and adds the video security system at the Mount Penn Tower site under maintenance. Several items are listed under the commissioners. Item A, adopt a resolution authorizing the Director of Elections to execute any and all documents required for use of a facility for polling place locations. Item B, adopt a resolution authorizing execution of an addendum to the agreement between the County of Berks and McCormick Taylor to provide construction inspection services for the rehabilitation project of Zettel Moyers Bridge, Long Road over Maiden Creek in Greenwich Township at a not-to-exceed amount of $113,510. And item C, adopt a resolution accepting the proposal and authorizing the chair to execute the consulting agreement between the County of Berks and WSK and Associates of Wyomissing to assist the county with the scoring of bids submitted in response to the bid specifications for CCTV, which is a camera security system, and the access control card system at the Courthouse Services Center, Coroner's Office, and Archives at a not-to-exceed amount of $10,000. Item two, motion authorizing execution of contract agreements and amendments as furnished by the contract coordinator as set forth on the attached listing dated March the 12th of 2019. There are a total of four contracts, one with court admin, one with the district attorney, one with the sheriff's office, and one with the solicitor. And then finally, a motion to ratify and confirm payments as set forth in the Comptroller's Office voucher listing. It's dated March the 12th for the week ending March the 13th, and the payment of electronic transfers and employee payroll that's been signed by the commissioners and is with our chief clerk.
Motion to approve the agenda as presented.
Second to the motion.
The motion has been made and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The motion is carried. With that, we'll turn to reports. In the absence of the treasurer, I will read the treasurer's report. The general account total is $141,678,452.56. There's a balance to clear of $7,371,231.32, leaving a balance of $134,307,221.24. And with that, we'll turn to Sandy Graffius, our county controller, with the controller's report.
Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning.
General accounts payable, $4,156,348. We had general accounts payable wire transfers of $3,434,599. There was no payroll, for a grand total of $7,590,948.56.
Thank you very much. And our chief financial officer, Mr. Bob Patrizio, with the agenda for this afternoon's budget ops meeting.
Good morning, commissioners. We do have a meeting today that starts at 2 o'clock, and we have four items on the agenda. We have a RACP grant presentation and policy discussion for the board, a task force realignment with our 911 director, city county next gen 911 with our 911 director, and a discussion about decentralization of our steam plant with our interim director of facilities.
Very good. Thank you. And Ron Seaman, our Chief Administrative Officer.
Thank you. I have nothing at this time.
With that, we'll turn to Commissioner Barnhart.
Thank you, Mr. Linebaugh. A couple of brief items. Back on the Commissioner's agenda, 94.19 Zettelmoyer's Bridge is one of our continuing efforts to transfer bridges. This one has been a long time coming, several years, and once this is rehabilitated, will be turned over to Greenwich Township. So moving along, we're trying to lower our infrastructure footprint in the county. What I have before you are medicine bags. These are safely disposable medicine bags, which Council on Chemical Abuse and SOS Berks, the Opioids Coalition, are distributing, primarily for folks who can't get to the drop boxes or the take-back events. You place your medicine in the bag, fill it halfway with warm water for about 30 seconds, then it makes the pills inert so you can no longer feel the effects of the medicines, and then you can throw them out with your normal trash. So we're going to have these available out in the community. If you want any, contact my office, and we'll get a box or two from COCA. We'll certainly get them out to you in the community. We want to make sure that these drugs do not get into the hands of folks who would be likely to abuse them. Our Census 2020 is moving right along. We have our major kickoff meeting on April 1st at 7:30 in the morning at Albright College, Rosner Hall. Probably have about 75 in attendance. We have numerous subcommittees from government to religion to community organizations that are really going to help us market and promote how important it is for the census to be the most accurate count possible here in Berks County. Census Day is April 1st. That's why we're kicking it off on April 1st, but next year, April 1st of 2020 is the actual date. So a lot to do. We already have put into place an employee who will be working through Albright, and we hope to put on a second employee probably a few months down the road. We do not do the census counting. That's a federal project. We are basically promoting and marketing the fact that everyone in Berks County needs to be counted. Due to the significant amount of federal dollars that flow into Berks County through the next 10 years, it really is very important. We've mentioned this many times. Each undercount counts for about $2,100 in lost federal money. So the average is about 16,000 missed in the last census. We want to lower that number down to something a lot less than 16,000 people because it's really important for the community. So I wanted to put that out there. And going to be at the Stigma on Ice event tomorrow night at the Royals game. So if you're looking for a night of entertainment, it's noticed in the paper today. It's to really educate folks about suicide prevention and to help lower those numbers as well. A lot of efforts being made for folks to reach out and get support, for the suicide prevention effort. So it's really a good time. Come on out. There's a lot of extra things taking place at the Royals game tomorrow night. So. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Commissioner Scott.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. At the risk of going into something that's somewhat beyond the interest of a lot of people, but shouldn't be, I'm going to talk a little bit about something I don't normally talk about, which is the County Commissioners Association of Pennsylvania and the National Association of Counties, and I'm not talking about anything involving travel expenses or any of that stuff. I'm talking about, and by the way, I think that the County Commissioners Association provides worthwhile educational services as well as other services derived from pooling of resources and knowledge so that all counties can share their experiences, their innovations, and benefit each other. In general, I think that the association provides a worthwhile benefit to participating counties. I don't normally participate in these things. I'm more focused on things here in Berks County. But I am interested in the association to the extent that it is a provider of retirement savings plan endorsements. I was asked when an email came across my computer seeking members to participate in the Deferred Compensation Committee and CCAP in Harrisburg. I volunteered. As some of you know, I have a strong interest in and have had since childhood in investing and in retirement planning To me, finance is interesting. To some people, it's burdensome. We're all different, but I take a strong interest in it. I took the time back in 2004 to obtain my certified financial planning certificate at my own personal expense, commuting for 3 years to New Jersey and attending evening classes. I continue to have a strong interest in retirement planning because many of the problems that our constituents present to us in correspondence and phone calls, et cetera, are derived from a failure to plan for the inevitable, which is retirement and old age. And would that I could encourage people to be more responsible with their money and to make better financial decisions. I'm somewhat aghast at the failure of our educational system to provide even basic instruction and training on personal finance. I think every high school in the United States should provide at least some basic education regarding personal financial decisions and financial planning. But that, in any event, I took it upon myself to participate in this committee. And I started off thinking that the goal of the committee, since it's called the Deferred Compensation Committee at CCAP, the County Commissioners Association of Pennsylvania, was to obtain the best possible outcomes for people who engage in retirement planning at the county level. This concerns thousands and thousands of county employees across the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and includes people in Berks County. Berks County has its own deferred compensation plan. We have two providers nationwide and another one that offer investment options so that people can accumulate tax-deferred savings for retirement. Unfortunately, the more I dug into the CCAP plan, I realized that my activities there were really restricted to dealing with Nationwide. Nationwide is the selected and endorsed provider of retirement services for county employees, and CCAP recommends them, endorses them, provides them with various levels of exposure to participating counties. 49 counties participate in the Nationwide plan, but I learned from my training in my evening classes that the expense, the annual fees associated with the retirement plan offered by Nationwide are very high relative to competitors. And then I dug down a little deeper and I found some troubling things, and I guess I became something of a troublemaker on the committee, a role I've from time to time played in other aspects of my life. But I want to read you a letter that I wrote following my fairly extensive research to the other committee members. And this is inside ball. I mean, some county employees watch these meetings. They would be interested. The public generally should be aware that if you have a 401k plan at work, you should be taking a good hard look at what your investment options are and what the fees associated with those options are, because gross returns minus fees equal net returns over 20 or 30 years of savings results in a pile of assets, a number, when you reach retirement, from which you can derive retirement income and security. To the extent that the fees diminish the pot of resources at the end of your working years, you are missing out. So the goal is to get the best returns with the best fees and the best choices. Everybody's different. People have different retirement goals, et cetera. But my research showed that the CCAP has a very anti-competitive approach to retirement planning for county employees. And so this is what I wrote to the committee members. And it raised some eyebrows, and now this is probably going to be, or it is, a subject for further discussion. There will be conference calls in the future dealing with this, as the members of the committee have had their eyes opened. Dear committee members, I write to express my deep ethical concerns regarding the CCAP Deferred Compensation Committee for reasons every county and commissioner should carefully consider. Based upon my research and experience, I've concluded that CCAP, through the committee, is promoting a retirement program that fails to serve the best interests of participating employees and thus encourages counties to breach a fiduciary duty. The evidence supporting my conclusion is compelling and specifically set forth as follows. First, due to the exclusive endorsement contract with the National Association of Counties, parentheses NACO, Nationwide is the only 457B plan, that's the deferred compensation plan for government employees, plan provider promoted by participating state associations. As one such association, CCAP receives a portion of the millions of dollars paid by Nationwide for the NACO exclusive endorsements, about $8 to $10 million a year. My understanding is that the annual revenue derived of this exclusive arrangement is approximately $85,000 annually to CCAP. This to me is nothing less than a pay-to-play relationship that is all too prevalent in politics. The payments from Nationwide for exclusivity prevent committee consideration of competing retirement plan providers, raising the specter of monopolistic pricing to the detriment of county employees. Secondly, the Nationwide plan fees, costs, and administrative expenses are unreasonably high, as one might expect from a firm pricing its service as a sole provider exempt from market competition. A commissioner motivated as I am to maximize returns and minimize investment expenses for his employees can find other plan providers charging one half the fees associated with comparable Nationwide investment options. In fact, Berks County has retained a provider of Vanguard index funds whose total fees to participants, including education, record keeping, and internet access, are less than 75 basis points, i.e., 0.75%. Third, by its own admission, see the attached, Nationwide engages in a practice described as revenue sharing, whereby, in addition to high fees charged to participating employees, Nationwide receives payments from some of the mutual funds it offers on its menu of investment options. I question whether Nationwide can objectively select superior mutual funds when fee-sharing incentives are considered in the selection process. This appears to be yet another layer of pay-to-play inherent in the Nationwide program. From the foregoing, it is clear that CCAP's endorsement and promotion of Nationwide's 457B program is anti-competitive, predicated upon conflicts of interest, needlessly expensive to plan participants, and generally not designed to serve the best interests of county employees investing for retirement. Hence, under these circumstances, I regard the Deferred Compensation Committee as little more than a tool exploited to legitimize a scheme to enrich Nationwide and CCAP at the expense of trusting, hardworking county employees. This is unacceptable. Were I to reform the committee's mission and function, I would terminate this endorsement contract and related payments, opting instead for a competitive procurement of plan proposals. With the aid of a financial consultant, the committee would select the best plan providers based upon criteria such as fees, service, fund performance, education, diversity of investment options, and the like. The selected firms would receive non-exclusive endorsement from CCAP and would be promoted by the Deferred Compensation Committee based upon their relative abilities to serve the diverse investment objectives and preferences of county employees. Under this proposal, the Deferred Compensation Committee would be acting in a truly fiduciary capacity, promoting optimal choice, performance, and service for county employee investors. This is our duty, and our respective workforces expect us to embrace it. We should resolve to reform our mission and act accordingly. Sincerely, yours truly. So, that's what I've done, and really, there's a fair amount of discussion of this now, and I'm hopeful that CCAP leadership, of which I am not a part, will pay close attention to what I've stated, which I believe is highly accurate, and reform the committee and engage in a competitive process to bring down costs and enhance the returns of individual employees. Individual employees, whether it's at the county level or in private employment, if you have a deferred compensation committee, plan, and you have very high fees, you're looking at retirement assets that can be tens of thousands of dollars less than they would have been had you been in a more cost-effective program. And there's a great deal of litigation under ERISA involving this now. Ironically, county plans are not governed by ERISA, but they are governed by the common law of fiduciary responsibility. And to my thinking, when you engage in monopolistic promotion of one single provider of a high fee plans, you are not adhering to your fiduciary duty as a plan sponsor, as individual commissioners are when they provide a deferred compensation plan. So in my view, CCAP, in exchange for these payoffs and this revenue stream, is financing its operations on the backs of county employees who are paying too much for what they're receiving in deferred compensation opportunities. So interestingly, the net assets of the 49 plans that are covered here around the state, something north of, I believe, of $300 million. Imagine the kind of competition that you would get from all these financial advisors out there who are scrambling now to gain or to retain their business if you went out as a County Commissioners Association and said, hey, guess what? We're going to promote one or two or three of the best plans that submit proposals to us, but you better sharpen your pencils and give us the best options and the best expense ratio for the benefit of our employees. And there's $300 million out there, and I think you get really great proposals. But that's never been done. I'm hopeful that that will be done in the future. Meanwhile, for anybody who is in a deferred compensation plan who's not a county employee, it still pays to take a good hard look at what your plan entails at your employer level and see what the costs, expenses, and returns are. And that's what I have to report. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Commissioner Scott. Several items. Tomorrow night, I also will be at the Reading Royals supporting our mental health and developmental disabilities team as they have the program Putting the Stigma on Ice. Saturday evening, we have the annual Farm Family Appreciation Dinner up at the Hamburg Fieldhouse. It'll be between 800 and 900 folks out at that event. I try to go every single year. Great group of people, overwhelmingly farm families from all across Berks County. Sticking with the theme of agriculture, next Tuesday is National Ag Day. The National Ag Day is intended, obviously, to support and promote the industry of agriculture. We will be having a program through our Berks County Agricultural Department over at the Ag Center that morning, and there will be a panel, and the topic is looking at the methane digesters. These are some systems that have been implemented in recent years to use food waste, animal waste, and other types of biodegradable waste to actually generate gas or generate power. Our facilitator for the panel will be Nora Goldstein. She is the editor of BioCycle magazine out of Rodale Institute in Emmaus. We have three panelists: Cheryl Cook, the Pennsylvania Department of Agriculture Deputy Secretary; Ned Foley of Two Particular Acres, Montgomery County, PA; and Lisa Remley of Remley Farms in Tioga County, Pennsylvania. Their farm actually has a significant methane digester, and she's going to be talking about how that program has worked for their operation. It begins at 8:30. It will end around noon, followed by open house of all of the ag partners, Penn State Extension, Conservation District, the Ag Department, FSA, NRCS. All will have their doors open, and also will be providing food for those that are there. I also want to note that we had an announcement of an award to our Parks Department, and I'll just read part of this letter. It's from the Pennsylvania Association of Environmental Educators. Good afternoon, Ms. Brooks. Congratulations. Your organization Berks County Park and Rec Department, the Seeds to Sprouts Organic Children's Garden was selected to receive the 2019 Pennsylvania Association of Environmental Educators Outstanding Environmental Education Program Award. This award recognizes an exemplary or innovative environmental education program, which could serve as a model of excellence for educators throughout the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. And they're going to be presenting the award to, I believe, Jennifer Brooks next Tuesday, March the 19th. And then the last item, does anybody know what today is?
National Potato Chip.
Pie Day.
National Potato Chip.
I'll go with pie. I like pie better than potato chip. And why is it Pie Day?
That's just something to do with
the numbers. Three, one, and four are the basis of pi. That's why they go with 3, 14.
I'll
so that's where it comes
chips.
From. So I'll tell you what. Eventually, we're going to have every day is going to be some national something or other day. But good article on the Eagle today, revolving around pies that you can eat to celebrate National Pie Day. That's all I have. Anything from our row officers? Yes, Sandy.
This past Friday night, Commissioner Barnhart and I went to the fundraiser for the library, the Reading Public Library. It was jammed, and I just want to tell everybody that Alan Carman, who is an accountant at RKL, snitched from right under my nose all of the restaurant coupons that they had, and it was just so depressing. He had taken a chance on buying a ticket, and he won, and then could have anything on all the tables.
So he didn't exactly snitch them then.
Oh, he snitched that right off and under my nose. There were hundreds of things he could have selected, and he took the thing that I was bidding on.
Okay.
And I want you to know that he used to be a junior achiever when I was president of the board. And so I'm really happy for the way he grew up and went into RKL and is now an accountant. And I explained to him that because he got those coupons that I expected to go to every place to eat with he and Lori when they went there.
So you invited yourself?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
Commissioner, I have
Jim.
One question. My question, and it goes to the census. You said, Commissioner Barnhart, that we missed 16,000 people in our count in the county.
Yes.
At $2,100 in federal aid. I guess my question is how do we know we missed them?
It's a
back and recount or something?
The national average is 4%. So we calculated 4% based on the national average, which came up to 16,000 people.
That's how you did it.
There you
go. I didn't know whether we went back and recounted and came up with that number. But so it's nationally people missed.
That's a national average, right. And then we also have targeted areas where there's undercounts, where basically people don't return their forms. Several of the areas in Reading and places like Kutztown University, where the students should be counted that day in their dorms and in their – what we found out through our planning department, it wasn't so much the students in the dorms, but it was ones living off campus were undercounted.
Okay.
So
thank you.
It actually involves about 130-some federal programs.
Wow.
That the money flows in from the federal government. So we want our share.
I learn something new every time I'm here.
Never too old to learn, Jim, right?
4%.
There you go.
Very good. Public comment. Just step up by your name and where you're from.
Patrick Murray, Shillington. Good morning. Good to see
morning.
You guys on a
good morning.
More positive note lately. Last week we had the Black Bloom Benefit Buffet. I want to publicly come and thank you guys for showing your support of something that truly is one of the highest things in Berks County that we should be focusing on. Also want to thank Karen. Without an article like that, without press coverage like this, this issue does not get addressed. So, while we may be a little people, I think she did more for it than I did, because getting it out to the entire public, she should be recognized for the efforts, too.
Thank you.
Proud to say, while our numbers were down from last year, we raised $5,000 that we will be donating 100% to SOS Berks, which will be funding the upcoming SOS Berks website, which will combat the opioid crisis fully. People were asking me, oh, you raised $1,000 less than last year. We had about 100 people less this year, but I think we actually reached more. And I keep telling people, the money to us is not the goal of the event. The goal is exactly what Karen helped us do, what Katira at WFMZ helped us do, what Irene helped us do. It's to reach the public and let them know how important this issue is. We lose more people to opioids and the overdoses than nearly everything around. It's the biggest issue that we need to focus on. So I would like to thank you two for continually coming out of the public. You know, you're going to the stigma event tomorrow night. Mm-hmm. These are the type of things that, as commissioners, I truly thank you guys that you are out in the public and, you know, doing good for all of us. And I look forward to more events with both of you guys to make us a better county. Thank you.
And SOS Berks thanks you for the contribution. Exactly. Much appreciated. Thank you.
Yes. Step up to the microphone, your name, and where you're from.
Elizabeth Schmoyer, Heidelberg Township. I want to thank Commissioner Scott for his information and enlightening information on finances this morning. most of our Berksheim residents don't have other financial options. Berks County has been committed to caring for the elderly and infirm since 1824. Don't break this sacred tradition for short-term gains. I urge county commissioners to do more research into those counties that have sold to for-profit companies. The state has committed to giving us more money for the county over the next 3 years in their budget. So I urge you again to take a good look at the Berksheim finances. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Someone else. Yes. Your name and where you're from, please.
Crystal Kowalski, Why I'm Missing. So I have a question. Have any tours occurred in the last week? And have any been scheduled? And if so, who has been scheduled? And then my comment has to do with the articles that Ford Turner has been putting in the Reading Eagle. And in those articles, our system's been compared to a predatory lending system, a bad finance company. And the reason those comparisons are being made is because of money, and that money is driving that system. There's been comments that we don't want to rush to any kind of changes, you know, that we need to do this methodically. If you look at the population that's been really systematically abused by these laws and these practices, I don't think they would see it as a rush that we would do something about this. So I'm very glad there's going to be a meeting. And I would ask that at that meeting, that population that is impacted, that they are present, that there's like some kind of citizen oversight board there, because to only have the players that have been in the system for years, and I have numbers here that I'm going to share, it's been years that this has been going on and that we've all known about it because someone died in our prison in June of 2014, and at that point it became national news. All right, so to assume that this is going to get fixed without some kind of outside oversight, I don't think is good sense. I have some dockets here, and one docket is from 2014, and the fees on this docket added up to over $600. It wasn't on truancy, it was on parking. And the thing that's really truly disturbing about it is this woman went to prison for 5 days. But on this docket, it has assessment amount, adjustment amount, non-monetary payment amount, and then balance. Well, in non-monetary payment amount, all these fees were placed because this woman paid her fees by being in jail. And, you know, that's a debtor's prison. There's Dan Kelly in an article in April of 2015. He has a sentence that says, Danino, 55, of Reading, died in prison while serving the weekend sentence to work off fines issued to her children for truancy. How does one work off fines? She wasn't working. her body was in prison. And so not only are these fines, those 600 that I just referred to, not being paid, being lots of them covered by the county, then taxpayers are also paying for that woman to be in prison. Thank you.
That was actually impressive from a timing standpoint. I mean, literally right on it. So thank you. We'll start. Christine, do you want to address the tours?
Yes. All tours have been scheduled. They're occurring in the near future. I can't give you specific names, but yes, we have a tour set up for five various companies to participate in tours at the time.
And as far as the constable issue, the one very important issue that we need to be aware of, the courts ultimately have the authority here. When I was first elected, I sat on a committee to look at this issue with then President Judge Jeff Schmale. Sandy was on that. District Attorney was part of that. Eric Weakneck. I think, Jim, were you part of that or no?
But I should be.
Yeah, and some changes were made then. I talked to President Judge Parisi early last year and said, this is something we need to do again. And nothing happened. I met with the President Judge Monday afternoon at a regular meeting, which was alluded to in the article, and we discussed this in great detail. He agrees that we need to do something, and he is unsure what his legal authority is as a president judge. He assured me that he is going to look into that and find out exactly what steps he can take in his role. The intent is to pull together a meeting of all of the stakeholders, and that is a fairly wide group of folks, and look at a number of things that have already been presented, looking at both the cost side and my comments in the paper. I've been very aware of the cost side, which is why I've brought this up multiple times to say, hey, is there something we can do? We don't set the fees. That's not the county's role. We don't set the rules for the constables. Constables, incidentally, are state creations of the state. We have a lot of things we think we know. One of them is you elect a constable within a jurisdiction. And the assumption is, well, why are constables working outside of their jurisdiction? Well, again, if you look at the state law that sets up constables, they don't have a jurisdiction. They can work pretty much anywhere in the state. So it's not as simple as saying, okay, this constable needs to stay in Exeter Township because that's where they were elected. So there are a lot of things that need to be dealt with. I think the biggest value of the article was a reiteration of the underbelly of the people that are largely missed in the discussion, and those are the individuals that are being layered with fine after fine. They can't afford the first one. How are they going to afford the second, the third, the fourth? And I believe they can be worked off, but jail isn't the place to work them off. We need to get back to the concept of community service, and I believe that's the appropriate way when someone does not have the financial wherewithal to pay these fines. Throwing them in jail doesn't do anybody any good, including the taxpayer, but it's devastating on the lives of those individuals. Community service is the appropriate solution from where I sit. I don't have the authority to make that happen, but we do have the ability to be part of a group that pulls everybody together and say, share that that's one of the solutions that I see, because I completely agree that people, I've taken the position that people that are truly nonviolent, as a rule, there are exceptions, shouldn't pay for their crime in jail. They should pay for their crime via community service. But we are working to get things together. I think, or my colleagues, I think you had said you were supportive of a meeting.
Absolutely.
Of the stakeholders.
You didn't read the Red Eagle article?
I read the Red Eagle article, okay. But I think we're all supportive.
Right. And I spent extensive time on the phone with Ford Turner myself, and one of the things I had said to him, the real driving of change here is we basically are the ones expending the money for these expenses and getting part of it back. But it's really starts in Harrisburg and works its way back here. Legislature amending the laws and the regulations and the requirements and the fee structure, and then it's also advocate of the president, judge, the MDJs, the commissioners, Jim and the control. Everyone's got to be involved in agreeing here at the county level. Something has to be changed and adjusted, and it's going to be acted upon by the state. We've got to be the drivers of the change here. Collectively, we all have to work together and agree, not separate, but agree that things need to be changed. And maybe we're the model for the rest of the state in areas that have a high poverty rate. I think that drives a lot of it, too. We've got Harrisburg, Allentown, York, and others that probably have the same dilemma we have. Certainly, it's not the answer to continuously pile on fees and fines and costs on people who can ill afford them. So definitely everyone has to come out of these meetings, and I said there'll be multiple meetings because it's big. I know the original articles were, gee, why doesn't the county know where all the money is? Well, that's a whole separate subject altogether. It's very difficult. I mean, you look at some of the folks who are paying $5 a month on their arrears or paying $5 a month in courts. It probably takes them years to pay these things back. So we've already expended $27.50 and other fees to the constables. They get paid up front, and then we're hoping at some point down the road to get some of that money back. So that's where a lot of the change, I think, needs to take place is what's being paid out. Of course, if I was a constable, I certainly don't know if I would be a constable if I had to wait till everyone paid their fines in order to get my fee paid. I mean, I'm not faulting them, but then again, if there's the ability to mail out postcards and get $27.50 for every postcard, I think that's one area that really needs to be looked at. I mean, they don't really have to go out and serve. They can sit at their desk and mail out postcards to people and say, I serve them $27.50. Things like that, I think, fundamentally can change. And I certainly don't support people sitting in jail working off their fines, as was said, either. There has to be a solution, and bringing enough people together. And it won't just be one meeting. It can't be, because there's so many players in this whole equation to try to knuckle down and figure this thing out. So,
yeah. And one of the solutions that had been suggested in a prior article, and I believe Lancaster County was highlighted, and I shared this with Ford, I don't believe the numbers that Lancaster County says they're saving $700,000 a year by turning all the constable work over to the sheriff's department. It doesn't fly. I talked to Sandy about that. I talked to Eric. I think Bob will agree. It's $100,000 to bring a sheriff's deputy on board. $100,000. I cannot see a financial savings for the county having sheriff's deputies deliver civil documents, and it doesn't make any sense. I think you can look in certain areas, and one of the areas that Eric has recommended and I support is those warrants for felonies and misdemeanors that have already been referred to the sheriff's department. Looking at the ability for the PJ to say constables can't go after those. That doesn't make sense. They've already been referred to the sheriff. They tend to be the more serious, more dangerous, higher risk. Those make sense. Another suggestion, and these were in the paper, that I strongly support, is getting rid of constables at night court. They're not necessary. Taking somebody physically from central booking to the courtroom is totally unnecessary. We have the ability to do video conferencing. Don't have to move them out. Just get the constables out of night court completely. And I already heard from one of the constables that said, I agree with that completely. That's unnecessary. So we have to look at it. When a constable brings somebody in and they have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 warrants, it costs the same amount of time and money to bring them in, whether they have one warrant or they have 20 warrants. There's got to be a different way to compensate a constable, in other than paying them full fees on every single one of those warrants. And in many cases, those individuals are people that they couldn't afford the first one, and it just it keeps loading up on the system. So there's some things that need to be looked at, and getting all the stakeholders together, I think, is a first step, but it's not the solution in and of itself.
Christian.
Yes.
I think that it would be helpful for people to know that we are mandated by our charges that are coming down from the state. We can't change that.
Mm-hmm.
What we do have is a county manual that any Berks County constable wants to follow the rules in Berks County and get paid in Berks County, they've got to follow the manual. Mm-hmm. When you and I sat on that committee a couple years mm-hmm. ago with Judge, Jeff Schmiel, we were able to tweak the manual that mm-hmm. we could change some of the fees that are paid as far as how many are piled on top of each person. We have the ability to change the manual, and if a constable wants to work in Berks County, they've got to follow that. We only have so many parameters we can stretch because we're working with what we have done at the state. It's also interesting to note that the people that are put in these payment plans, if they move or if they stop paying, then after 6 months, their warrants are reissued. And so the same people that were charged 6 months before that, the whole circle starts again. So when they don't pay their fees, then that drops everything back into the barrel, and we start all over again with the $27.50. Some of these things we can address with the manual. Some of the things we can't change because it's on the state mm-hmm. level. If a sheriff's deputy starts to go out and serve the warrants, it's not going to change the revenue coming in if the person doesn't have the money.
Right.
So this all has... there are so many, as you said, so many moving parts. But the only thing we can do when we are trying to control this in Berks County is to change that manual. And if the constables don't want to live by our Berks County manual, then they just don't get paid here. You must get elected in the area that you live. So there's only one constable coming from each area. But once you're elected, if you're in St. Lawrence or Burnville, you can work all over the state, which is what you were mm-hmm. saying. But you must be elected in the area where you live.
Yep. Very good.
Motion to adjourn.
Meeting is adjourned.